I have come again in this letter to bring together all the loose ends of my other letters and present them within a world context, showing how these teachings are relevant to every aspect of your earthly lives and to all nations. These letters are meant to be the impetus, the spur, to a personal opening of the mind and heart to your source of being, and eventually to become the means of your perfect understanding of the effects of individual and mass thought and behavior on every facet of your earthly existence. Whereas in the past the laws given you for national behavior have been directed mainly at "you shall not, if you do, this will be the penalty," true spiritual laws are entirely different. They are expressed like this: because you and your place in earthly existence have been created in this way, if you work harmoniously with the laws of your existence, you will open your entire system of soul, mind, emotions, body, and personal circumstances to the consistent inflow of divine consciousness, your life force. The fruits of your disciplined behavior will return to bless and load you with health, harmony, and prosperity. If, on the other hand, you ignore these laws of existence and continue living as you did before you received this message, then your lives will continue to be punctuated by turmoil, difficult climactic conditions, pests in your crops, financial disasters, famines, and stressful lives. I have spoken through these letters expressly to enable you to reach true, consistent peace of mind and spiritual love, joy, and inner healing of mind, emotions, and body. You should have understood by now that this was also the sole purpose behind my last mission to people on earth, to show them how they themselves were creating their own misery. You have been taught by Christian churches that you who have been created by God must worship and please God by keeping His laws. But this is not truth. Worshipping God is a pagan ritual. When people worship God, they set God apart and above them, unreachable and to be feared. For who knows what evil He might send on earth if people do not act according to His will. But that was not the message I brought to earth. I spoke of the Father which supplied all needs, which answered when called, which healed when requested to do so, which was both transcendent to people and also within them, meaning that the Creator was universal. The Jewish religion taught that only the chief priests could approach the Holy of Holies and make supplication for the people. The populace could approach Jehovah only through the priests, by bringing birds and animals to be offered as burnt sacrifices to appease Jehovah for the people's sins. By these means, the Jews obtained forgiveness of sin. I repeatedly taught the people that they would receive the Father's forgiveness of sins according to people's willingness to forgive others, for it would be done to them according to their own sowing. I also taught the people to approach the Father directly and pray in simple terms, asking for what they needed in life, and assured them that they would be heard and their prayers answered, providing they prayed with total faith, with no doubt in their minds. You must understand that everything I taught the Jews was in direct conflict and opposition to what their religious elders taught them, which was why the priests hated and crucified me, since I was robbing them of their exalted positions as personal henchmen of the Almighty. Because, for fear of reprisals after my death, the disciples did not break entirely free from the Old Testament, much of the Old Testament thought was carried forward into the Christian religion. Instead of animals, the body and blood of Jesus were substituted to be the sacrifice offered by priests upon the altar. After many years and the entry of Rome as protector of the Christian religion, like the Jewish priests before them, the Roman priests dressed themselves in costly vestments and used silver and gold appurtenances for religious ceremonies. In the time of Paul, this would have been unthinkable. His was a simple message of salvation by my death on the cross, which was not the message I brought to my countrymen in Palestine. He was perpetuating a Jewish tradition of sacrificing another to pay for one's own sinning. What shameful cowardice! Yet Paul also performed a great service to humanity, since he set in motion a movement which would be the means of blessing all races equally. He outlined a mode of thought and daily conduct which would bring harmony into the lives of those who tried to live according to his teachings. In all probability, some Jewish traditionalists will vociferously reject my words again, the second time of coming. They will resent my constant allusion to the ancient Jewish practice of sacrificing animals and birds in a temple to please God and obtain forgiveness of sins. But no matter what their objections may be, the historical fact remains that the temple was a place for offering burned sacrifices, and the smell thereof hung over Jerusalem. And all the while, I knew that the whole edifice of the temple was dedicated to a myth, a figment of man's imagination, a rationalization of what men's minds could not comprehend spiritually. I was there. I felt the hot stones under my sandaled feet and the sun on my head. I argued with the Pharisees, bore their mockery and sneers with some amusement, and watched them as they dogmatically taught a burdensome way of life of continual obedience to a worthless tradition concerning eating and drinking what was entirely unnecessary. I was there. At times my amusement ignited a spark of mischief in my mind, and I handed out to the Pharisees the same kind of analytical mockery of their personal habits, their ostentatious clothing, and their laws as they applied to me and my teachings. "He is a fool," they said, and loudly ridiculed my statement, "The kingdom of God is within you." "Tell us, how could God be within a person?" they shouted derisively. Using a barrage of contemptuous arguments, they called on the prophets and compared their concepts of the Almighty Jehovah with my descriptions of the simple Father, who even had thought for birds. "How could this be?" they demanded, "when birds were regularly sacrificed in the temple for payment of man's sinning. Would Moses have instituted such a holy practice of burned sacrifices if birds and beasts were of any consequence in the eyes of the Almighty?" I remained unmoved as they launched their verbal attacks at me. They only had the conviction of Jewish tradition to support their statements, while my mind had been imbued with the true knowledge of existence itself during my illumined experiences in the desert. I had been given understanding of the universality and creative goodwill of the Father, which enabled me to perceive and do things which no chief priest or Pharisee or Sadducee or scribe could ever do. Because I understood the nature of our source of being, I could, with confidence, put my hand upon a crippled man and raise him up to wholeness again. Who could measure this knowledge against the ridiculous traditional laws of the priests? The priests and Pharisees and all the rest of the religious hocus-pocus knew that none of them could do such things, and for this reason they hated me for challenging their authority, they loathed me for my strength in the face of their opposition, and they reviled me for drawing crowds of people when a healing was done which no one could deny. There it was. Done in the open, for all to see, an act of love which the priest averred only God could do, and therefore I must be a child of Satan. Furthermore, they did not see the healing as an act of love, but rather as an inexplicable, blasphemous usurpation of the role of God. They accused me of showing off my magical powers, but could not tell me how I came by such magical powers. Therefore, they decided I must be a son of Beelzebub. Now that I have explained the situation, it should now be as clear to you who read these words as it was so very clear to me at that time in Palestine, that the whole hierarchy of Judaism was composed of self-centered, self-important, mixed-up men who lived only by rules and laws. When challenged to use their minds, their brains, they could not cope, but fell into highly emotional spasms of vitriolic outrage. Was it any wonder that when brought before their council, I held my peace and refused to communicate with such obtuse minds? Yes, I was truly there in Palestine 2,000 years ago. I lived amongst the ordinary men and women who had been taught to fear Jehovah in a very real way, who were obsessed with paying for burned sacrifice to ward off punishment for their sins. I was raised, indoctrinated in the fear of Jehovah, but I had been born to bring the Jews out of their long slumber of myth and fallacies, to set them free of a burdensome history of wars and bloodshed, brawling and argument, of demanding a head for the loss of an eye, of hidden and secret sinning which counted for nothing if a man was not found out. If he was, then the whole weight of the Mosaic law descended on his head without compassion or mercy or even a hesitant thought as to the true circumstances surrounding the transgression. Because I had been born with a mission to open up the minds and hearts of the Jews to the reality which had given them life and being, even from an early age, I rejected the Jewish teachings. Some secret depth of spiritual instinct rebelled against the age-old Jewish intention to let some other living thing carry responsibility and pay the price for their own waywardness and sinning. Even more than this, I could not accept that a God who was supposed to have created such a wonderful world would rejoice in burned sacrifices of his own creation, for which he had provided abundantly. I found it impossible to have respect for such illogical beliefs and practices. After my illumination in the desert, I became passionate in my rejection of Jewish traditions. Just as I came in human body 2,000 years ago to rescue the Jewish nation from an edifice of artificial and man-made burdensome religious practices, so have I come through the medium of these letters distributed worldwide to make it abundantly clear that the Christian religion in no way reflects my true Christ message, either as I taught it in Palestine or at this present time when these letters will arouse the fury and condemnation of Orthodox Christians. The Christian religion, as it stands at this time, is only a hodgepodge of muddled thinking of my disciples' selective recollections and Paul's worthy homilies and other early writings. Much later, when the impact of Christianity lacked the visual effect of the gods and goddesses of the Romans, the Christian religion was adorned with theatrical but expedient nonsense to impress those whom the ecclesiastical empire of Rome desired to draw into their fold. This empire later imposed monetary burdens on the gullible people, even more iniquitous than the taxes demanded by the secular Roman Empire on conquered nations. Even Caesar did not demand payment for souls to gain entrance to heaven. You may wonder why I am so explicit in my rejection of Judaism and Christianity. It is vital to the success of the distribution of my Christ message that people should fully understand the true nature of religions which held humanity in their grip until the 20th century. Until they do realize the mythical foundations on which they have placed all their convictions, people will find it difficult to let go of their cherished beliefs. Please understand that when I make such statements, I am referring to Christian religion, to the tenets of faith, to the dogma and theology. I am not referring to those great spiritual souls who have sought and continue to seek God and truth beyond the dogma and beliefs. Many of these have received my inspiration into their minds and hearts, but are afraid to let go of their cherished beliefs. They are hampered by religious practices. The time has come for them to let go and grow in spirituality and awareness of their true source of being and take their congregations with them. To the Christian churches of every denomination, I say, wake up! The time has come for you to rouse yourself from a long, unnatural sleep when reason has been suppressed by hypnotic and emotional traditions. These have been handed down through the centuries by a succession of people claiming to be the highest authority on all that I taught in Palestine. Do not be afraid of the consequences if you examine your past beliefs and want to cleanse them from your thinking. Get rid of the cobwebs of illusion and think. When Christian ministers fully accept that I, the Christ, have truly returned to speak to people worldwide, like lightning striking from east to west, and are ready to teach my true message from the pulpit, you will find your churches filling again with people eager to find and make contact with the reality, which will lead them to live in total harmony with their truth of being. Alternatively, you ministers of religion, who willfully and egotistically continue to teach the dogma of Christianity to save face and your stipends, will watch your religion die a natural death during the next 30 years and will be abandoned by your congregations who are already sensing that your words are only words, in which there is no spiritual life. You will see your churches taken over by those who have realized that I, myself, have indeed returned to humanity to show them the way to find and enter the kingdom of heaven. There will also be those whose positions of authority are threatened by these letters from Christ, from me. They will oppose them mightily. There will be vilification of every kind through the services of every type of media, from people who have no scruples in stirring up public wrath to make money from destructive, vindictive sensationalism. I have to tell you that the greater the uproar worldwide, the more swiftly will my letters reach and convince those people who are weary of the old beliefs that at last they have heard the simple truth of being. They will swiftly respond to its love and call to leave their lower levels of human consciousness to start their ascent to the higher spiritual levels, where they will begin to experience the first inflow of interior peace and contentment. There will be conflict throughout the entertainment industry, since more and more people will recognize and turn against the violence and degradation with which their entire consciousness of mind, emotions, body have been fed by degenerates obsessed with making themselves a fortune.
These spiritual ghouls have understood the strange fascination of the unholy and macabre for ignorant people who have been so surfeited with the security, comfort, and luxury in the 20th century, they no longer find contentment in them. They need excitement to stimulate their jaded consciousness.
Were the lives of people truly as horrible as is depicted on the entertainment they watch daily, they would turn from their screens in search of something beautiful and easeful to rest their tortured nervous systems. And yet, if you reflect honestly on the conditions of your present lives, you will realize that they are already becoming a terror-inducing mirror image of all that your entertainment industry has given you in the past 50 years. People have been fed on the worst scenarios possible by cinema, TV, books, and media sensationalism, and are now complaining that the former sense of security they previously enjoyed has been whipped away from them. I see you on earth, presently barricaded behind electric fences, high spiked walls, guarded by security men who themselves traitorously murder the people they guard. I see men and women who previously walked the streets and country lanes fearlessly at night, now locked up behind security gates, afraid of the most despicable and brutal attacks. I see races traumatized by their own people. I see genocide, revolutions, bombing, assassinations, mindless killings of every description. The murdered come through into their next existence still traumatized by the shock of their unexpected passing. I see them and minister to them, if they are able to see and receive me. Many, many people are far from ready to move on to a higher form of existence, and so they dwell in the shadows until they are released through rebirth. Earthly life has become the hell which you depict on your screens and in your literature. Why? Because your so-called civilized culture permits brutality in all its perverted forms to enter your homes through the medium of your TV for your titillation and excitement. You wanted it, and now you have it in its most real form, within your own daily experiences. No one is immune from these disasters you have brought on yourselves. Do you wonder that I, the Christ, have returned to you at this time to explain to you what you have done to yourselves? How would it be possible for any spiritual embodiment of love to remain remote from such agony of spirit and fail to reach out to render help when help is possible? Therefore, as I said before, I am not alone in my work. I speak for every master as I speak through these letters. Every master is ministering to those who follow his earthly teachings. Every master is calling on their adherents to read, heed, pray, that they may absorb the truth within these pages and strive to cleanse their thoughts and actions and become the embodiment of love to all. But these letters will set in motion a season of change. When people truly wake up to what has been done to their consciousness worldwide by greedy, unscrupulous, and degenerate tycoons, they will experience extreme anger. The public will begin to recognize the insidious and devious ways in which they have been gradually enticed into the webs of abomination. And I, the Christ, have to tell you that when this happens, you will no longer find the word abomination old-fashioned and out of date. You will clearly perceive the difference between wholesome, life-giving consciousness forms, words, and destructive consciousness patterns. You will rebel and nationally call the destructive consciousness forms abominations. Conscientious and truly loving parents will become particularly vocal against the present form of entertainment and will prevent their children from continuing to view the decadence of unpleasant, emotive language, unbridled violence, and promiscuous, emotionally superficial sex presently on offer on your screens, in books, and media. Your society is riddled with these low, despicable consciousness creations which are carried through into human lives and human actions.
Parents will also come to realize that since the consciousness forms created within their children's minds are the ever-enlarging foundations of their children's future lives as adults, they will begin to investigate the ethical values taught in schools. No longer will parents be concerned about the religions taught in school, since these will only be of interest to a minority, but they will be very seriously interested in the kinds of philosophies for living, attitudes, arguments, conflicts, statements, encouraged or tolerated in schools in the future, by teachers and by pupils alike. Groups will band together to start small schools on the foundation of these letters, since the old factual material will be abandoned as obsolete. Emphasis will be placed on languages, the arts, logic, the art of effective, inspiring communication, the development of constructive, creative imagination, mathematics and science, and manual skills. The curriculum will be centered around the development of an ability to differentiate between truth and myth, to perceive clearly the highest values to be adopted and cherished, and the most constructive, productive way to use them in life, to improve conditions for the self, the nation, and the world generally. The child will also be taught to become proficient in those sciences and manual skills which will enable him to work joyfully and successfully in his chosen field of endeavor. Children will be tutored within a new aura of concern and love and shown how they can contribute to such concern and love in the classrooms. They will be encouraged to work with joy and happiness. If this does not come easily, the unhappy child will be shown how joy and happiness may be achieved and will be rewarded when successful. People will be valued according to their commitment to seeking higher levels of spiritual thought and their dedication to serving the interests of the underprivileged and communities generally. It is a matter of extreme urgency that people worldwide should recognize that the truth is you have been born to individualize and express the universal, the source of your being, in an evolutionary manner, eventually reaching peak individualized manifestation of your source of being, Christ's consciousness. And you have also been created to be cared for, nurtured, provided with your every need in order to ensure your health, perfect well-being, and harmonious prosperity
while on your soul's journey to individualize reunion with your source of being, divine consciousness. Until you do grasp this truth of being, you will never achieve your true potential on earth, either physically or spiritually. No country, religious organization, and no single person, no matter how humanly exalted he may be thought to be, will be able to alter the contents of these letters, since I, the Christ, am also radiating the truth of being worldwide to everyone who is on the level of spiritual frequencies to be able to receive the truth. Such people will receive, revere, and adopt it fully without reservation to be their own guidelines for their thoughts and actions. If there are those who cannot understand or receive the letters, it will be only because they are not yet ascended to the necessary level of consciousness to be able to empathize with them. Their growth will come later. Therefore, I say to those who have not yet experienced the quality of life I have described as being yours by divine will, do not ask what is the matter with life or people or circumstances or with you. Look inside your own thought processes, your own attitudes toward life, generally, your feelings toward other people and yourself, and find out what kind of thoughts and expectations you regularly indulge in. These create a powerfully creative consciousness energy force which you are emitting throughout the day. It will attract to you exactly what you fear and expect. Sometimes the negative creative consciousness form is deeply buried in your subconscious, implanted there many years ago due to certain circumstances. Or the negative creative consciousness impulse may have come through from a past life. In any event, if you have been subjected to consistently bad experiences, examine your inner state of consciousness and find out what kind of negative expectations possess your subconscious. Discover also, what are your attitudes and feelings towards other people? Are you consistently living within the harmony of the laws of existence? Are you expressing unconditional love on every level of your life, toward every single thing in your experience? Are you able to see the light of the soul within all living things, or can you see only their ego drive, their darkness? Do you realize that for people whom you may reject or criticize, I, the Christ, have the highest love and compassion for them at all times? Whom you may be rejecting, I am radiating them my unconditional love. Bear in mind at all times that your source of being is in two states, in equilibrium and activity. The active state of your source of being is the dimension in which you have been conceived and given individualization. The equilibrium of universal consciousness is the dimension of perfect silence and stillness, in which the underlying impulses of creativity are locked together in an embrace of mutual restraint. When you fully realize, accept, understand that in every learning session in your school on earth, you always have access to the divine loving intelligence which resolves every problem the perfect way, you are then lifted beyond the reach of panic and pain. You solve your problems swiftly and smoothly and realize that your own store of wisdom and knowledge are increased in many ways. In this way, do you evolve on every level of your being.
While my purpose in coming to you through the medium of these letters has been to show you the way to live in harmony with the laws of existence, to help you avoid unnecessary pain, limitations, deprivation caused by your ignorance of the laws, I also want to imprint in your consciousness that everyone is subject to rhythms in their lives. Everyone goes through the high periods when an inflow of blessedness brings you all the things you have wanted and you are on a peak of human happiness and success. You rejoice. Then comes the time when suddenly the rhythm of life changes, resources dry up, relationships become difficult and precarious, your career takes a downward turn, or obstacles occur which keep you static for a long time. You may ask yourself what you have done wrong. Previously you worked very successfully within the laws of existence, but now there are daily challenges and nothing you think or do is truly alleviating the stress of your daily life. When, if these times come upon you, be still and quiet within your heart and mind, and know that you are still drawing life and direction from divine consciousness, despite appearances to the contrary, despite the superficial agonies. At these times, it is essential to withdraw and take stock of the ways in which you may have slipped in consciousness during your up times, and strengthen your dependence on divine consciousness. Without these dark periods of depression, you would not grow in spiritual stature. They have a special message for you, so do not give way to despair or bitterness. Although you may feel fragile, this is your winter season of self-discovery and inner renewal, which will ultimately prove to be of greater blessing than ever were your peak periods. Take heart and do not lose faith. Hold on patiently until winter gradually yields to your spiritual spring again. Persevere in relaxing and confidently waiting for the time when divine life will again flow into your mind, heart, and earthly life, and all you had hoped for will begin to manifest in your experience. And throughout this time, realize and hold on to the fact that if you are no longer aware of the inflow of divine consciousness during your meditations, it is not because you have been abandoned, but because your own cosmic and therefore your personal consciousness vibrations are at a low ebb and you are no longer able to rise to experience the vibrations of divine consciousness as you did previously. Although you may not feel them, rest assured that always you are enfolded in them and in divine love. I also want to remind you and impress upon your consciousness that the moment the most impoverished of human beings can understand the true nature of their origins and can make use of the knowledge, they can begin to pull themselves out of their rut and can then rise to any heights they choose for themselves, providing, daily, they tune into their source of being and draw on its infinite power, life, direction, inspiration, and guidance. You are not victims of fate, you are victims of your own creative consciousness until you realize your consciousness is entirely of your own shaping. When this glorious truth dawns within your own consciousness, you will begin to turn your life around and will eventually discover that you can work to become a master and achieve complete freedom in divine consciousness. Try to remember that in your spiritual search, your aim should be to keep your consciousness frequencies as steady as possible within your highest spiritual perceptions. This is extremely difficult for the human mind to do, since it eagerly reaches out for new forms of spiritual mental stimulation wherever the interest is aroused. But I have to tell you, it is not enough to read these letters and then turn to other books hoping to find some higher, more inspirational truth. I, the Christ, tell you truly, there is no higher truth or higher way on offer to you at this time. You may sometimes feel you have found something higher because on the level of your present human consciousness, you can relate to what is written more easily. But you can rest assured that spiritual truth of existence is the only knowledge which will bring you eventually to Christ consciousness, which is your true destination and none other. Christ consciousness is the spiritual consciousness of all great masters. There is no higher. To increase your understanding, you may seek out those authors who have already found for themselves and are practicing what is written in these letters, but do not follow those who still follow other writers and quote other authorities and are still seeking a way through human thought into the vastness of spiritual truth beyond human thought. They, like yourselves, are still in the foothills of consciousness. They have not yet penetrated the mental, emotional ozone to draw close to the precincts of space. Do not follow those who are finding pleasure in and writing of marvels in occult practices and are seeking to lead you into experiencing them also, advocating the use of material substances to increase energy in different areas of your life. When you use material substances such as crystals, candles, incense, joss sticks, you focus your human consciousness on those things which have human meaning for you and give you pleasure. In this way, do they anchor your human consciousness to the effects of human consciousness, continually leading you back into fixed levels of human consciousness. Whereas, if you want to ascend into true spiritual dimensions of consciousness, your goal is to penetrate and then transcend the earthly human consciousness dimension. The only true energy, true dynamic healing life force, comes from your consistent contact with divine consciousness. As you journey upwards, you will become acquainted with the finer vibrations of the astral planes, but do not loiter in these levels, since they are only manifestations of higher physical forms of consciousness and should not be your true goal. Attunement with divine consciousness and total self-mastery should be your reason for living and your only goal. When you have achieved it, all you have ever wanted for yourself will be yours in a new, transcendent, and eternal way. You may read these letters and decide you want to continue as you are, in your ego consciousness, trusting divine consciousness to help you through the difficult patches. But I can tell you that life itself will eventually convince you that any other way does not bring the rewards which your soul, hidden and silently waiting for release, is longing to experience, particularly that of full reunion with divine consciousness. The greatest gift you can give yourself, or anyone else, is to gratefully accept into your own mind and try to imbue other receptive minds the full inspired understanding of who you and they really are and what can truly be accomplished when you and they abandon self-will and look to the source of their being for help, guidance, and fulfillment of every need. Become a light to yourself and whomever can receive it. At the same time, no one can absorb learning on an empty stomach. Therefore, a certain amount of physical nutrition should be given to help the process of spiritual, physical, evolutionary development if you are trying to teach the materially impoverished. Be willing to give to others and know that as you give, you become part of the give and receive system of the entire universe. It is impossible to give and not receive in return unless you yourself believe you live only on the supply from your work, your bank account, and investments. When this is what you believe, then this is what you will experience. Until people truly wake up and open their eyes to the full realization that they are the individualization of the source of their being, which is a combination of perfect impulses of creativity and love, they will remain attracted to the enticements of materialism, satisfaction of body lusts, and the desire for self-promotion above all others, which ranges from takeovers and strikes in business and industries, and gross disharmony in relationships, to murder, rape, and war. Wherever a person exerts his ego over another, angry discords abound. This is the first law of existence which must be publicized throughout the world. How then should human nature strive daily to live in a world naturally dominated by ego drive, the overpowering desire for self-satisfaction? The answer lies in my statement, "Do to others as you would be done by." This is the first step to overcoming ego drive. When involved in argument, let there be full justice rendered by each party to the other. Listen, absorb, heed, make amends as far as possible. Make certain that in your demands you do not make inroads on the well-being of the other party, be it personal, pleasure, business, or industry. Remember that as you do to others, so will it eventually be done to you. Remember that your thoughts, words, and actions of today will take on form in your experience in days, months, or years to come. Sometimes the sowing will take years to grow into its harvest, and the sowing will have been forgotten. However, rest assured, whatever you do today will return to you in some related form, although you may never recognize it as such or perceive the connection. Whatever you would have people say about your mistakes, say those things and mean them about the mistakes that other people may make, friends or strangers. Give the acceptance and forgiveness you would like to receive. What is true forgiveness?
It is a state of understanding the other person and their reasons for their behavior so clearly that you can say in all honesty, there is nothing to forgive. The loyalty, kindness, and generosity you would like to receive when in trouble, give to others when they are struggling with heavy burdens. Never turn to them a cold shoulder. Learn to look at a person or a situation with an eye of kindly discernment. See them as they are at this moment, and then remember that I see them with compassionate love. If you see a need for improvement in them for their own good and the future enhancement of their well-being, look at them only with heart and eyes of love and see them as they can be in the future. Take them in thought to their source of being and know that your prayer has surely blessed them and opened doors to their development. Seek guidance from divine consciousness as to whether you can broach the subject of their improvement and ask how this may be done to ensure their happy acceptance of counsel and ultimate success in personal development. If someone wants to tell you how you have hurt them at any time, stand or sit still quietly and know that this is a true challenge to your ego drive. This is your big moment, your greatest testing point. How will you handle it? Will you make excuses and defend yourself, considering even saying that your actions should not have hurt the other person and were fully justified in the circumstances? If this is how you respond, then your ego drive is still in perfect control of your consciousness. If, however, you can realize that the great moment of truth is upon you, and because of this awareness, you are able to remain quiet and calm, listening to the other person's description of their hurt at your hands, you are succeeding in the first overcoming of your ego. The next urgent step is to put your own need to defend yourself firmly aside and sincerely empathize with what the speaker is saying. You will only be able to do this sincerely if you can be self-effacing enough to enter a place of inner silence where you can fully enter into their hurt, hear what they are saying, and receive their pain into your heart. If you can do this, you will have got inside their skin. And when you can get inside their skin and feel their pain, you will want to apologize from the very bottom of your heart for what you did. The pain you inflicted ignorantly and unknowingly will become your own pain, and you will not rest until you have managed through loving words to remove all residue of pain from the other person's consciousness. You will then have healed the hurt, and it will also be eliminated from your electromagnetic consciousness system. You have won a great victory over self. You will have reached that point of inner strength and endurance when you can truly perceive the reality of other people as being of equal validity with your own. You have recognized and accepted that others can be hurt by your actions in just the same way as you have been hurt by others. After reaching this great moment of truth in your life, you will find yourself able to move between yourself and others quite comfortably, able to see events from their perspective as easily as you can see your own. A great balancing between the needs of other people and yourself takes place, and you enter into a state of peace since you are now confident that you treat others fairly and with generosity of spirit. You have now begun to remove the barriers between yourself and other people and are receiving them into your heart. You have also begun to remove your own defenses, and because of this, you will find that, at last, you are achieving true self-esteem and peace of mind. This new understanding of the feelings of others will inspire in you a great respect for them. You will always want to deal with them justly, giving them their dues, never wanting to take advantage of their good nature, never wanting to put them down, reduce their self-esteem, always ready to encourage and pick them up when they're in pain, physical or emotional. You will find yourself doing these things for yourself also. You will become your own counselor, support, healer.
You will see each person, no matter what their status, as of an equal basic reality as your own, and you will see that you are the equal of everyone else, be he king, pope, or president, for underneath the externals you have both come out of the great unity of being. Therefore, you will no longer feel inadequate in any situation because you have moved forward in the strength and wisdom drawn from divine consciousness and recognize that you, too, have equal rights with everyone else. Quietly, calmly, you will not allow others to take advantage of you. You will be able to speak your mind clearly and honestly with due regard for the feelings of the other person. You will no longer want to denigrate another and reduce their self-esteem. Rather, will you make every effort to save their self-respect, yet relating your truth in a clear but loving way. Remember, when stating your truth to another, it is not within your province to tell them how they should act in any given circumstance or how they should react to your words. However, standing by universal values of perfect honesty, conscientious work, goodwill towards all, caring for the underprivileged, a person is entitled to demand that these values should take precedence over every other consideration of expediency within a group or community enterprise or national endeavor. You also have a perfect right to say how you are made to feel by a person's belittling behavior towards you, should you be aware of a need to do so. It is probable that your caring honesty may be necessary to solve or clarify a certain situation for the good of all. State your case with kindness. Gently tell them how you feel in the present unpleasant circumstances, and explain what has made you feel that way. Do not say, "You did such and such a thing," because they will feel you are blaming them, and immediately you will arouse the ego defense mechanism in the other person. Thereafter, the confrontation will become difficult and unpleasant for both of you. To get through to ego-driven people, you must continually speak in such a way as they will never feel threatened. This is the art of loving communication, and you can only learn it by trial and error and dedicated practice. Each time you conquer ego in yourself, it becomes that much easier to relate to others because you are reaching an understanding of the function of ego in all people. As time passes and you are gradually released from the grip of your ego drive, you will find that, more and more, you can listen to others with soul empathy and love. If they behave in a way which would have hurt or offended you previously, you will feel the welling up of laughter instead. You will then know that your soul is in direct touch with divine consciousness, for its natural state is that of laughter.